switch on your videos.
PVSM, AVSM, VSM. He's a veteran of the Indian Navy and has served the nation for more than 40 years and retired as the Chief of Logistics, Indian Navy. He has left an indelible mark with his logistics infrastructure plan for 20 years and harnessed IT in the supply chain management for the Navy. He has been part of the Indian peacekeeping operations and was the flag officer for INS Hamla, the largest material depot for the Navy. He specializes in administration and logistics management. He also has a distinguished educational profile with degrees like Masters of Philosophy, Masters of Science, and Master of Management Studies. He is also a keen sportsman who excels in squash and is now an avid golfer. He is a recipient of 3 presidential medals, Param Vishisht Seva Medal, Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, and Vishisht Seva Medal. The Param Vishisht Seva Medal being the highest peacetime award presented by the President of India. Sir, it's an honor to have you amongst us and a true privilege to be hosting you. We're all, the entire batch is really excited to learn about value-based leadership and negotiations from you. So you're on mute, sir. So you're on mute, sir. So you can press Alt A and it'll just unmute. So we can't hear you, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir. Audible now.
All right. Okay. All right.
Yes.
Thank you for your patience. Thank you, Nitesh, for very kind words. And I hope you continue to hold your opinion at the end of this talk. And for the rest of you, you need to take Nitesh's words with a pinch of salt, as is my son Arjun's buddy. And he's bound to say some good words about me. And Nitesh has used all his negotiation skills to ensure that I speak on the topics of his choosing. But at the outset, I would like to thank the XLRI Leadership Committee for this wonderful opportunity to interact with the bright minds in the future of our country. I always gain immensely from such interactions with young people, and actually, they don't make me old. So coming to the topic, I will attempt to keep a two-way communication with some inputs of the concepts. And the three issues that I intend covering are lessons learned by me that I think may be relevant to you. The second is the value-based leadership concepts and traits as I imbibe them. And third, important elements of negotiations and my practices. Some of the issues I will gloss over for the paucity of time and can be covered in question hour. So I grouped the lessons of my journey as shown on the screen, and I will deliberate them one by one. I was born and brought up in a place called Mandsaur. It's a district town in MP. And if you, ladies and gentlemen, have not heard about Mandsaur earlier, then you are unlikely to be called by the Narcotics Control Bureau in Sushant Singh murder case for testifying. Because Mandsaur used to be the largest producer of opium and infamous for smuggling before actually the government stepped in and they licensed the cultivation of opium. People there are most friendly, very homely, and least ambitious. The toppers of the schools and colleges, they join the bank job so they can remain within the, you know, traveling distance of the town. And I come from a very humble background, as my both parents were teachers. And one of the most important lessons in my father's word, I would say, was failure isn't, but low aim is crime. This is what actually manifested in my joining Navy and moving out of Mandsaur. My early influences were from a host of books my parents ensured that I read, and most favorite of them were Panchatantra stories, biographies of warrior. And I've been quoting many of these stories and with their moral lessons to drive a point home. Even now, I find them very interesting. My schooling, what they call it, was from KPP. And, well, I would like to challenge the complete August gathering here, if you can crack what the KPP means. Anyone like to hazard a guess?
Something to do with Kendriya Vidyalaya kind of naming convention.
I'll just elaborate this without wasting much time. In the Navy, if anybody who is not from either a Sainik school or from a convent school, he's termed to be from KPP. And the KPP stands for Kanya Putri Pathshala. That's how, you know, the distinction is made. And there's, of course, this story, how I'm from being a biology student, I joined maths, but I'll skip the story for to save time. While in college, unlike you guys, I just wanted to run away from studies. And luckily I got selected to join Navy, and I joined Navy. My formative years in the Navy, on joining Navy, the first thing they did was to shatter my dreams by giving large number of books to study on the subjects hitherto unheard of. But the emphasis was on all-round development of personality and not merely knowledge. The mantra was, Navy is not a job, but a way of life. And more about that later. The involvement was 24/7, unlike 9-to-5 job. Yet, the oxymoronic lesson was work hard and play hard. And it's never about work. There's life beyond work. It taught us the value of time and value of life. Over the course of time, I found it was very important to pursue some other interests to maintain the sanity. The thing I did and would suggest that you must do things besides giving your 100% job, and that is follow a sports passionately. Football, golf, NBA, Formula One, whatever you choose. Like Nitesh mentioned, I'm a keen golfer. And my reputation in Navy was more of a golfer than a logistician. It's a tragedy that I became the chief of logistics. It's something, you know, something like that. Hum ispat bhi banate hain. And I don't know whether you still remember that ad of Sale Authority of India, Steel Authority of India. Have interest in some art, playing instrument, painting, poetry, or bathroom singing, which I do. And take part in adventure activities. Test your limits. You'll be surprised at your own capabilities. But the most important things that this will change your outlook and rejuvenate you for enhanced work and performance. I'm a qualified skydiver with the first jump at a very young age of 52 years. There's an interesting anecdote to that also, but maybe later. While climbing the ladder in the Navy, one learned not to worry about promotions, but focus on enjoying the job. This helps you in leading a stress-free life. Never brood about what boss thinks about you. If at all, pay some attention to your subordinates' view, as they are your responsibility. Remember, sometimes quite unrelated activities or events have a bearing on your life. Learn to take them with a stride, else that will make you a better person. In my career, most of the time I moved jobs at somebody else's BS. Somebody in Delhi was not getting along with his boss, so you know he has to be drafted out. I get replaced, and suddenly leaving all family behind, you have to rush and join it. And likewise, there are many issues that happen to you, and you can't be blaming anybody for that. They're saying in the Navy that one must respect people on your way up as you'll meet them on your way down. Be humble, have humility. It costs nothing to be nice to people. Always remember that people and good relations are the fundamental to your success in achieving your organizational goals. And lastly, my dear wife reminded me to state that a happy family is the key to your better performance. Never neglect your family. They are the most important people in your life. And as I became a flag officer, obviously one had a different view of a lot many things. But what I learned is the people are the most important assets. Create a good team. In the Navy, we are like a small family. This culture is easy to create. All you need to do is to make small informal communications with the personnel of your team. Just inquire about their family, children, parents, health, their interests, and just make a mental note. This works wonders, and that's what makes Navy a way of life. As a leader, one must have a vision with a long-term approach. In every appointment of mine, I made out a 25 years perspective plan, a vision and a mission statement, and a roadmap for guidance. Invest time and energy in sound planning efforts. United States is the most powerful nation because of insistence on sound planning. To give an example, in 2004, when tsunami struck, I was commanding Material Organization Mumbai, which is a mother depot of the Indian Navy. And we were asked to arrange a variety of relief material at a very short notice. We are not prepared for the range and scale of requirements. Somehow we were able to meet the requirement in a reasonable time frame, but it led to delay. It was a big lesson. Immediately afterwards, we got down to the drawing board, made a plan with a list of requirements of different contingencies, different kind of requirement for different regions, and bundle them in a 1,000 people package, which was called BRICS. So you can load them at a short notice. Eventually, it got promulgated as a national policy, and every requirement of relief operation thereafter has been effectively met at a 4 hours notice. Attention to details. This is a very important trait for a sound planning or decision making. And I have Akbar Birbal's story, but if you're interested, I'll tell you later. Difficulties and failures are the opportunities to do better. With every setback, you should come out a better person. once one of the big industries was asked that when you select a CEO for a large corporate, what question do you ask them? Since all listed people have already left their mark in their career, and that is well known, there's nothing new that you would learn. The answer was, we asked them only one question, and that is, what is your biggest failure? And how did you deal with it? So ultimately what? Failure teaches you much more than success can. Integrity and honor are the most important virtues. There's no substitute to it. It does not require any further elaboration either. Transparency is not just about doing the right thing, but seem to be doing the right thing. In today's world, we are like open book, which everybody can read. We can't suffer from ostrich syndrome, bury our head in sand and think no one is watching us, or that we shall pass. Coming to the second topic of my talk, I believe value-based leadership is the most relevant today when most of the myths have been bursted by the COVID-19 pandemic. I intend covering these issues on the screen one by one in detail. Corporate scenario as I view them. Corporations today seem adrift in a sea of change. We experience a truly global economy. Innovation and change are happening at astounding speeds. Competitive pressure is far greater than it has ever been. In the midst of these pressures, most corporations claim that people resources are their primary competitive advantages. Yet, according to a widely acclaimed study, less than 1/3 of the workforce is actively engaged in their work. The rest are just putting in time, or worse, passively working against the organization. Organizations live and die by their leadership. Ultimately, is the leader's effectiveness in creating a vision for a preferred future and establishing an appropriate culture that determines organizations' results. Therefore, significance of leadership in any organization to deliver lasting positive output cannot be overemphasized. So let's discuss leaders and leadership. Often the question is asked, are the leaders born or are they made? Interestingly, as you know, the answer to both is resounding yes. The fact is, while some people seem to have an innate leadership talent, others must work at developing leadership ability. But irrespective of the fact, the point is, most of us lead in one capacity or another at some point in our life. Leadership is all about influence, and regardless of our natural gifts, we can develop and demonstrate excellent leadership ability by how we impact those we lead. Leadership is not about positional power or the ability to make people do our will. Perhaps Peter Drucker, the father of the management, modern management, said it best. He said, and I quote, "If you think you are a leader and no one is following you, you are just out taking a walk," unquote. True leadership is about earning authority through our personal conduct, personal example, and actions so that people choose to follow us. In short, a leader is the one with willing follower. The value-based leadership focuses on who we are and how we behave rather than the positional power. Leaders and their organizations can best execute their mission and achieve superior results by first addressing the foundation of behavior and performance. Personal and shared values. Values determine behavior, and behavior determines performance. Value-based leaders effectively engage, motivate, and develop their followers. Establish a culture that enables transformational sustainable change, resulting in effective execution, innovation, and outstanding performance. Value-based leadership is a philosophy that brings value to organization, to customer, to suppliers, to shareholders, without focus on personal gain. It is about creating value for the sake of the organization and its mission, and for the sake of the society as a whole. When leaders embrace VBL, then only and only then can they realize the personal fulfillment and lasting significance. It is through this selfless pursuit of worthy goals that individual leaders will attain legacy with lasting impact. Perhaps this notion sounds like a lofty ideal or a daydream. However, it is the foundation for a true leadership success. The power of the values, value determines our behavior, and value precedes ethics, precedes diversity, and leads to behavior, which ultimately precedes the performance. And I would say superior performance. The process of VBL. Take, for example, the value of integrity. When leaders value integrity, it leads to the belief that being honest and authentic is important and makes a positive difference in working with others. This belief leads to thoughts about how they might demonstrate integrity through words and actions, which governs their choices about doing what is right, about telling the truth, about doing what they say they will do. Integrity-oriented choices result in observable and measurable behavior that builds trust with employees, customers, suppliers, and shareholders. Collectively, the behavior determines specific performance. Performance that develops a trust culture, creating an environment for flawless execution, creativity, innovation, and commitment of employees, loyal customers, and ultimately results in positive growth and significant return on investment. Successful value-based leader. A leader must embrace VBL in their words and behavior. They should understand the current reality and define a compelling vision and a mission for a preferred future. Based on this cultural foundation, leaders must establish behavioral norms to motivate employees to effectively execute the mission, resulting in innovation, enhanced morale, improved efficiency, increased productivity, and greater operational effectiveness. A holistic and ethical approach to achieve organizational goals along with the right attributes will produce satisfied customers, repeat businesses, and will naturally generate revenue and profit, leading to growth. Establish a communication process to implement the mission, vision, and values, and develop appropriate strategies. Importantly, leaders must live the values and walk the talk. In short, to be a successful value-based leader, his thoughts, his speech, and his action, they have to be in synchronization. So what you think, naturally, you should be able to speak. And what you speak should reflect in your actions. You should be seen to be doing this. This will lead to trust and draw willing followers. Coming to the traits of a leader. Demonstrate integrity. Setting uncompromising example. One's conduct has to be above board at all times to lead by personal example. Serve selflessly and raise up others in genuine humility. Humility is the one indispensable trait of value-based leaders, because leaders who demonstrate true humility are best able to motivate followers to have high level of execution and performance. Mumbai floods, for example, in Depot. I recollect, in 2005, we had, you all remember some movies also been made on that, where there was very severe floods. And the Depot was in the Ghatkopar. All people actually got stuck. All our storehouses, we had some 54 storehouses. they're just getting filled up with water. My own house was also, the depot house was in the same premises, and there was water coming in the house. But the more important to look after, and the whole, luckily for us, all this heavy rain started during the working hours. So I advise all people to just stay calm here and we'll look after you. And by the time the news came, they all, everything's in. Some of them, despite listening to the advice, some few 20 to 30 people decided to go out. But rest of the employees, including ladies, and there are about 1,800 people in the organization at that point of time, they all stayed there. I pigeon myself in shorts and, you know, into all storehouses, checking around with the waist deep waters. And all, everybody, all the civilian people, they responded. Arrangements were made to cook meals for them. The arrangements were made for them to, ladies, to sleep separately. Arrangements were made to all the important electronics and other items which are lying in low-lying storehouses to be put on top. And everybody rose to occasion. So you see, it's just that you have to understand. Similarly, show compassion by caring for others and help in developing their true potential. Ensure a purpose-driven alignment with corporate mission, vision, and values. Demonstrate courage and perseverance to do the right thing. And I'll give one example here. I was commanding a logistic base called INS Hamla, which runs the MBA programs for the naval officers. And they get an MBA degree now from Mumbai University. So I was commanding that base, and one of the monsoons, it is on the coast in Marwe, Malala Beach. And during monsoons, the severe monsoons, we had a lot of structures, nice shacks and, you know, houses on the seafront. So there, all the sand was getting eroded, the water was coming in the shacks. So we had taken away a proposal to make a wall there. CWPRS, which is Central Water and Power Research Station, is a central government body. They had decided that they're given a drawing for a wall that will make. So when I took on the, all took photographs and all things, and then ensure that under the emergency power, which is rarely exercised for establishment, is only for the ship. So under the emergency power, this work was sanctioned. And this is, mind you, in 2003. And the total, I think it was about 10 crore rupees at that time, the large work, because seawall has to be made. And they started the work. I was very happy that, you know, something nice I have done. Got the sanction and the wall is being made also. And the truck loads of those stones will come and they'll start dumping there. And they're just, you know, one top of a small stone, big stone, you know, they're making wall. So I saw and I was very happy and started close to my house, which is also on the seafront. Incidentally, the commanding officer Hamla and the governor of Maharashtra, these are only two people who have their private beaches in Mumbai. So my house has a private beach. That's on the latter side. So this wall was being made, and, you know, and then I went there, asked the contractor, "Bhai, tum apna wall kab banana shuru karega?" "Bolta sahab, ye wall ban raha hai." I said, "You're only dumping stones. When are you making wall?" "But no, this is the wall we are making. This will stop all storm coming inside." "So, okay, where did you make this wall earlier?" "Well, we made it at, Warsaw." I said, "Okay." I got my car, my gypsy, and I said, "Bed your piece," and took my second in command and drove to Warsaw. And mind you, I was shocked. Those who have been to Warsaw and they've seen it, it's such a pathetic sight. With all kinds of, you know, dirt lying in the stones, all plastics and what have you, and stinking. I said, "My God, if this wall comes up here, Hamla Beach, which we pride, which is one of the finest beaches in Mumbai, mind you, and what will happen?" I said, "Just stop the work." And they were, "You said, 'Okay, stop karega, to contract ho gaya hamara,' I said, "No, no, just stop the work." Got the work done. And then I rang up my chief engineer. I said, "Look," he said, "No, Chevant, you can't stop it. because it's an emergency power, you got it done, you know, this has to be completed in time. And the work was being undertaken by the government of Maharashtra, PWD, who were there, you know, sieving, they had something. CWP has given the, you have given the. I said, no, whatever it is, but this wall can't come up here, just stop. And by then, I think they already made some 25 lakhs investment. And which in 2003 was a big amount. So of course, you know, and then the CNC meanwhile, who had given me the sanction. I was very happy with him. I mean, he had a good equation. The new guy had come. And in his you know, introduction, when they were giving presentation to him, they said, this, the commanding officer, Amla, is a, you know, is a kind of dictator and, you know, not doing the right thing. Got sanctioned emergency power against all our advice. And now he stopped the work. And of course, the boss was very upset and he was coming us to pay his initial visit. So what I did now, you know, at that point of time, your career is finished if you are doing something like this, idiotic stuff. So I told my deputy man, okay, let's do one thing. It can't be, you know, we are the first time making some beach wall. Just go on the internet search and find out where the wall walls are being made. And then we found out Hawaii, Florida, all beach, you know, they called it sand retaining walls or beach restoration walls. I said, that's it. Just so we got nice those pictures. And then we took the worst pictures of Warsaw Beach, you know, Warsaw Wall. And when the boss came here and we wanted to give a presentation, and I used to play squash those days. I was, you know, maybe number one in squash at some point of time. And I was still, you know, very regular in squash. He was a very good squash player. And like a good soldier, I gave him a good fight and lost. And then after that, when we were walking on the beach, and I told him, sir, I just want to discuss with you this. He said, no, no, we are not going to discuss here. When we are, you're giving presentation, then we're going to discuss. I said, okay, fine. And so I knew visibly that he was very upset with whatever they've been told to him. We had the presentation. He said, you know, wall, I'll discuss later. First, you everything else, so that, you know, so that I don't lose my temper. I mean, okay, fine. We did all this. He said, now you tell me, how can first you get the work sanctioned under emergency power, and now you have audacity to stop it? I said, yes, sir. And I, of course, and you must understand that if I do this, I have a valid reason. So I told him, because this is the wall being made, and I got them CWPRS, all those guys who were given that drawing and all that. So they were there present, and chief engineer present, and everybody. And chief engineer was a friend of mine. He said, I'll defend you, don't worry, but you know, there's a limit that I can do. That's fair enough. So I said, you know, I showed him, Menka sir, you know, we got this upper general kahani background. I said, this is the wall they are making and what stone they have thrown to us. And I said, when this get completed, it is going to be like this. I showed him also these pictures. Menka, you understand this, sir, that this beach is not just the pride of Hamla. We use it for our training. Our cross country is there. Our boys go there. Our families go there. They run and they physically fit, they keep, and then this is a very important requirement. We can't have some, you know, stone wall coming in, this beach going off. He says, yeah. So what? You want your structure to be protected, and you don't want wall? I said, no, I want the wall, but I want my beach too. And then I showed him Florida, in some Japan, and you know, various places such walls have been made. Then he said, yeah, my God, this is good. And we tried to avoid, you know, no big knees over there and all that. Just let them in. So I said, is this possible to make wall which is, you know, which can meet their requirement, our requirement? So he asked CWPS. He said, why can't you make a wall like this? He said, sir, we have been given such, you know, the criteria that wall should retain, you know, some gale, storm and everything else. This is the one. Nobody told us that you have to preserve the beach. If they say you preserve the beach, then we would have given different structure. So I said, sir, that's it. So he asked chief engineer, what can we do? Chief engineer, I said, a friend of mine. He said, sir, I think I understand this point of view, and I think it's very valid. So we'll do. And finally, you know, everything got diffused, and now we have a beautiful wall. And mind you, all the beach sand, the beach is getting restored. All the sand which was eroded is coming back there. It was a lovely sight to see. And I'm very proud. But at that point of time, even my staff and you know everybody else, he's like, sir, chhod do usko. So courage is very important. And there's no substitute to it. Have self-discipline, fix accountability, and hold yourself and others accountable. Show gratitude, appreciation, and acknowledge the contributions of others. It always helps to give credit of achievements to your subordinates. So for the leadership, the last point, negotiations. There seems to be no school of negotiation. Those who are successful in negotiations become so by doing many deals. In other words, they learn from their experiences. Over the years, I discovered a number of issues regarding negotiations, which I'll be covering under the heading as shown on the screen. But to put all these issues in perspective, I'm going to tell you a case, a live case, my personal example. It's called flag procurement case. Some of you may recollect in 2016, February, we had something called International Fleet Review, which was the chief guest was the President of India, the Prime Minister of India was, and a lot of guys, and there were ships and dignitaries from 100 countries were attending that functions. They'd send their ships for international fleet review. So our ships must look good and they must have, the most modern flags. So a case came to us in sometime mid-2015 to buy flags. And somebody had supplied some flags which were tried at ships in various weather conditions and they would look beautiful. Now you can see, on this photograph, those flags are there fluttering. These are the same flags that we bought. So they should look nice, colorful. They should have long lasting impression, very easy, very light, and all those things were done. And the case came to us. We floated tender inquiry to the known, those who were developed, those who were, given for trials and everything. And also a lot of vendors. The quote came to about 11.5 crore. And the flags for 100 ships, basically the national flag, the naval ensign, all those lines of flag that you see for a whole lot of ships and also for some bases which are supposed to visit it. So, since we did not, this is a new material, a new thing, no specifications available, no previous data was available. But somehow we did some estimation that if we buy the normal flags, they would have cost some, 2-3 crore rupees. And so this should be maybe double or something like that. And some kind of study was carried out and the board arrived at price of 6.5 crore. But the quote was 11.5 crore during negotiation. Then we tried to find out and say, okay, let's ask them to justify the cost since specs are not there. And the firm was not at all willing to negotiate. He said, no, sir, I put a lot of time and energy and I've been at it for almost more than a year. We are given this flag for trying and this thing, everything has been done. And now you're telling me the cost is high. I says, look, there has to be some justification. You have to give me a breakdown of cost. And I give them a week. You just give us a breakdown. He says, I'll give tomorrow. Manka, not tomorrow. You take a week. And then give us after a week and you come back. And you send us at least a day in advance so that we are able to study this. Went back, got a decision. And there was a lot of pressure. The director who's responsible for having this flag there, he said, you told the chief of naval staff, he said, sir, the case is getting delayed and we may not have flags. The chief called me up and he's like, okay. I said, don't worry, flags will come, not worry. But we have to follow some financial propriety and follow some norms. And he said, oh, perfectly all right, do that. And so after 1 week, I sent my guys to town. A lady officer had gone, I gave him some jawan, you go around and find all flag manufacturers in Delhi. I was posted in Delhi, a chief of logistics. So they went around Delhi and she came back in the evening. He's like, sir, we contacted so many flag manufacturers. None of them, the people to make this flag, they don't even know this material. I said, oh, okay, doesn't matter. So my staff officer, man Friday, he's risen from rank and now retired ultimately as a honorary sub-lieutenant. So So I said, OP, just go to town and just try and find this cloth. That's all I want. I said, don't worry about the flag. I think we've done the wrong search. So you go to the flag and find it. So he found the flag, found the material. And I said, and then I worked out. With all cause, give and take, and I arrived at it should never cross 5.5 crore or 6 crore at the best. And giving all those things, we should only going some round, came to the same 6.5 crore. It was later actually became 6.5 crore, not earlier. So with that, I said, okay, let's do research more. Who's this firm and what are they doing? We found out with the firm's research that the three quotes were there. One of the guy who was quoted for the firm, who was the lowest quote, had never made flags in his life. His profile on the thing showed, he's supplying air conditioners, light fixtures, office materials and all that. And then another firm, which sounded, something different name and doing some other business. Third guy was manufacturing flags and, in some manner, supplied some flags somewhere. But he was not a known supplier at all. None of our known suppliers had quoted for this flag. Because we are buying as per sample. It's an open tender inquiry. We buy as per sample and nobody knew the specifications. And people, unless you have correct specification, nobody, quote for the item. So they didn't even understand. So anyway, so now I was armed. And then I found out that the two firms were brothers. And the dad who had come that day was on the board of both the firms. I said, oh, so I knew ki dal mein kala nahi, dal kali hai. So we went for negotiation, but since we are August time, it was already August, and it has to be, order has to be placed, it has to get clear, it will take about 10 to 15 days. He has to start manufacturing process, then, to buy a cloth, print. And we are, by time, we are fully knew exactly what goes into that manufacturing system. And the time was against us, naturally. So we went into a negotiation. I told him, look, your price is high and we just cannot go along with this. And you better come back. He said, sir, last time I told you 5%, I just cannot reduce anything. I'll give 6%. If you insist 7%, and that's it, sir, I put a lot of time, energy, and you are already delaying this order. You are putting us on the back foot because, we have to meet this deadline. And they were supposed to be there on 26 January flying on the Republic Day with the ships getting dressed overall, as you see on this thing. And of course, he wouldn't agree. I said, fine. I told him, look, we require some time to discuss. So you kindly wait outside and we'll let you know. I made a couple of calls from the guys. Why are you sharpening the quote? I'm not the specs. I said, now I got a specs. I said, now you're going to do this. I think we should be able to make all that. So I had some assurance. And there's another guy who's supplying us some clothing items. A new fellow, young fellow, very energetic. Another Guju. And they're very, very innovative. I'm very proud of, these other people when it comes to business. Sorry, I'm taking a little long, but unless the story is interesting, you will not really enjoy it. So, long and short of it, I've taken a decision that we're going to re-tender this case. And re-tender and get the quotes and everything else. My financial advisor was always telling us how not to order. This time he says, sir, you have to order. This is L1. You are actually breaking rule. You know nothing, the requirement, you shortlisted everything. He has tried everything. How can you say no? Because I am the CFA, I am the competent financial authority. I say no. And in the short time, I rang up my chief and I told him, sir, we cannot take the flag. We will not be able to justify ourselves if we place the order. And I promise you, I guarantee you, your flags will come. He said, yeah, that's all I want. Thank you. So we closed that deal. I put the phone down. I said, just re-gender. So every hour, he said, sir, are you sure? I said, yes, I'm very sure. Just re-tender. And I told these guys. They again wanted to meet me. They want to improve offer. I said, no. Decision taken. We are re-tendering this case. If they want to meet you, I don't want to meet anybody now. Thank you. I went by my business and everything. And these guys were waiting for me in corridor when I was going for lunch. He said, sir, aap naraaz ho gaye. Main kaha, naraaz ki baat nahi bhaiya. Main to servant hai, to government ke servant hai, aapke servant hai. Hamara kaam hi hai. But hum koi kaam galat tarike se nahi kar sakte. Hum chahte hain ki aap, you must make profit. But that profit must be reasonable, must be justifiable. And that's my, you know, way I talk about it. So, humne decision le liya, hum re-tender kar rahe hain. Aur hum aapko tender inquiry denge. आप रिकॉर्ड करिएगा, नो प्रॉब्लम, आप वो सुनिए, आपका ऑर्डर मिल जाएगा. बट मैंने कहा एक बात मैं प्रॉमिस कर रहा हूँ आपको, सिर्फ वो ये कि दिस टाइम दिस नॉट बी अ काइंड ऑफ अ सिंगल टेंडर सिचुएशन. दिस टाइम देयर विल बी रियल पीपल विल बी कोटिंग इट, एंड इफ योर कोट इज नॉट गुड इनफ यू विल नॉट गेट द ऑर्डर. बट यू डन सो मच ऑफ मेहनत, यू नो एग्जैक्टली वॉट गोज इन टू इट, यू शुड बी एबल टू कोट एब्सोल्यूट रीजनेबल प्राइस. आई ऑल्सो वॉन्ट यू टू मेक प्रॉफिट, बट लूटना नहीं अलाउड है. सो एनी वे वी रिटर्न दिस केस एंड वी कल्टिवेटेड कॉन्टैक्ट. द फ्रेंड यू नो हिज नेम इज अनिल शाह, कंपनी कॉल लीफ ज्वेल. ओके, हो सकता है मैं कर दूंगा गुजराती फिल्म. माइंड यू, व्हेन द कोर्ट केम आफ्टर 4 weeks ऑफ you know, short tendering, because it's open tender. You have to give that much of time. It had to get published in newspapers and all that. It was 4.3 crore. From 11 crore, 4.3 crore. Now, I was shocked. I said, he's not court kar diya hai, but he'll be able to supply, not supply, he'll meet requirement, not meet requirement. And before that, in this tender inquiry, we also said that before we clear your case, specifications are there, you have to supply one sample piece in advance. Only if your sample pieces get cleared by our professional director, then we'll buy. Otherwise, we'll not buy. This guy produced the best sample piece for the same cloth with much beautiful, you know, colors and everything else. There are a lot of efforts were made to give usko aata nahi hai, usko pehle supply nahi kiya. I said, dusra wala bhi nahi kiya. So you can't reject, you reject both or reject. That fellow had quoted 8 crore from 11 crore. He came to 8 crore. The other guy, flag manufacturer, who was, we got later on got to know, there is a partnership with him, underquoted him, quoted 7 crore, but 4.3 crore was way below. Anyway, we placed the order, flags came, and you can see them, how they're flying. So that is the, you know, story. So sometimes you have to really, you know, what is this? Okay, coming to stages of negotiations. Now, in this context, we'll go and see how, you know, this thing fan out. Prepare. You must define your objective. There must be a specific, achievable, and measurable. In other words, you must have a clear idea what you want to achieve from the other party. An objective should be also be put in order of the priority and classify them. Must achieve, intend to achieve, like to achieve. The research is also part of the preparations. As chairman of Naval Logistics Committee, at least 3 days earlier, before the actual negotiation, I used to have a review of the cases with procurement officer and principal director to ensure that all required information is available. So that's preparation. The next stage is discuss. This is a process of exploring each party's needs, starting with tentative opening offers. Analyze the other party's reaction to what you say. Use an opening statement covering the main issues at stake. Allow the discussion to develop naturally. Make it clear that at this stage, you just wish to talk, not negotiate the price. Establish a relationship with other person. Ask questions to find out more about their needs and keep things moving to find a mutually acceptable solution. Propose. This is a stage where you are giving and receiving proposal and suggestions beyond your RFP. Remember to trade things, not just to concede them. Look for the opportunity to trade things which are cheap for you to give, but valuable to other party, and in return for things which are valuable to you. Bargain. After discussing each other's requirements and exchanging information, the bargain can start. Generally speaking, you receive more if you start off asking for more, or you will concede less if you start off offering less. In any negotiation, you quickly need to discuss whether there's any likelihood that you might be able to reach a satisfactory agreement. Never disclose your offer first. seek other party's offer first. When the other party's offer has been made, the next step is to find out exactly what it includes. Ask for clarifications. You'll have a prepared list of your own requirements in preparation stage. So evaluate and ensure that these are met. When agreement is in sight, listen for verbal indications, such as maybe or perhaps. Look for the non-verbal signs, for example, papers being tidied away. It is time to summarize what has been discussed and agreed. Offer a summary of what has been agreed. This will give a chance to confirm any decisions. As soon as possible, immediately after the agreement, put it down in writing, because agreement in writing is better than a handshake on deal. Elements of negotiations. Power. The other side always seems to have more power and authority than you think you have. Time. The other side doesn't seem to be under same kind of organizational pressure, time constraints, and restrictive deadlines as you feel that you are under. Information. The other side seems to know more about you and your needs than you know about them and their needs. And we'll look at them in some details one by one. Types of power. Power is the capacity or ability to get things done, to exercise control over people, events, situation, and also oneself. As such, it isn't good or bad. It is not moral or immoral. It is not ethical or unethical. It's neutral. Power should never be a goal or end in itself. It should be transported to a destination, to your objectives. There are different types of power listed on the screen. And we can discuss these powers if someone needs to, any elaboration during question hours. Coming to time, this reality that all actions occur at the 11th hour holds true for every single negotiation. Therefore, in negotiation, settlement action occurs close to the deadline. That being the case, if I know your deadline and you don't know mine, who has the advantage? Naturally, I will. Because as we near the point that you perceive as the deadline, your stress level will increase and you'll make concessions. Deadlines, your own and others, are more flexible than you realize. Your boss, the government, a customer, or a family member. They may have something to do with it, but primarily, your deadline is your own making. Always ask yourself, how great is the risk I am taking by going beyond the deadline? So you must, like in that case we've seen, it was a clear deadline. Yeah. And the it's the perception. Oh, we'll not be able to meet, we'll not be able to meet if you don't place the order. You have to be, you know, you must know your audience is the same. Coming to information. During the actual negotiations event, it is often common strategy for one or both sides to conceal their true interests, needs, and priorities. The rationale is that information is power, particularly in situations where you cannot trust the other side fully. You should ask questions even when you think you know the answers, because by doing so, you test the credibility of the other side. You can gather information from those who work or have worked in the past with the other party, or those who have negotiated with the same party in the past. And of course, thirdly, the competitors of the other party. Batna and Zopa. Batna is a term coined by Roger Fisher in 1981 in his bestseller, Getting to Yes, Negotiating Without Giving In. It stands for best alternative to a negotiated agreement. Termed in another way, if other person refuses to negotiate with you, or if they tell you to go jump in the lake or get lost, like it happened in the flag case. So Batna is the best that you can do without them or in the eventuality of failed negotiations. And Batnas are critical to negotiation Because you cannot make a wise decision about whether to accept an unfavorable agreement unless you have a better alternative. So having a good partner increases your negotiating power. And then coming back to the same flag case. Since we already knew, we had done our homework, it was possible to make, and the other people who do, we had another alternative. And therefore, one could take a decision of it. ZOPA stands for Zone of Possible Agreement. This is a zone in which both the negotiating parties agree to each other. This phase in which they can be satisfied of what they have got. Coming to my personal tips, my personal practical tips, and I'll take one by one in each of the help. Coming to preparations. Make a check-off list of points for discussions, clarification, and as I just discussed at length earlier. Don't assume that the items on your agenda are the same as those on other parties' agenda. Try and prepare for the possible points that may be raised by other party. Firstly, decide your destination, what you want to achieve. Then work backward to decide the best way to get there. In negotiations and as in life, if you don't have a plan of your own, you will be part of someone else's plan. Gather information about other party. It helps a great deal, as we discussed earlier, especially about their needs and deadlines. Have clarity on taxation and duties. They have a significant bearing on the pricing. Be sure of technical specification. They should have been clearly specified in the RFP. Ensure and record full compliance of specifications while placing the order. And there's a case of diving, interesting case of diving compressor. You know, a diving compressor is one which our divers take it on a boat. And one of the important specification of that was of weight. Okay, that should not be more than 70 kg. So that two divers can lift it and take it on the boat. And we've been generally importing this from Hemworthy and Dial compressors and all that. And their compressors are very nice, sleek and all that. We got into indigenization, the firm called Goenka. He had indigenized this firm also. And we placed the order. We got some, but they were very heavy, beyond 90 kg. And they could not be, you know, handled by taking on the board. So next time when we threw a tender inquiry, we rejected his quote and placed the order on the next quote. And we saved almost a crore rupees because what happens in these orders that the all indigenous firms, they get a 15 or 20% price discount based on, you know, over the foreign suppliers for indigenization effort. And of course, we took that view because it was not suitable. But just because of the specification, then this level kept on, you know, making cases. And we got saved just because, you know, the specification was clearly there. Okay, coming to the attitude. Treat negotiation as game, maybe video games. When it comes to negotiation, you need to be involved. But don't get too involved. If you are too emotionally involved, you will lose your perspective and make emotional rather than subjective decisions. Try to be innocent. Don't have to show off your knowledge. Especially to the power negotiator. Smart is dumb and dumb is smart. When you are negotiating, you are better off acting as if you know less than everybody else. Try saying something like this, you know, oh, well, I don't know. I'm new to this. You are the expert. So you need to help me understand this. This is exactly what I did in flag case. We have flag banaya nahi, kabhi kharide nahi. Aap bataiye kaise banate hain. What do you have? So he gave me all the jan in that first negotiation. Kaise karte hain, kapda kahan jata hai, where you do all that. So, you know, they often reveal more than they actually care about. And obviously, and they forget about their own needs and what they will be doing and what to concede. Near often the other party. The secret is to try to establish what is on their agenda and in what order. In other words, what is most important to them. It's not about winning at all cost. some negotiators try to get what they want at the expense of other party. You should have the ability to recognize it. Otherwise, you may be victimized by it. Like in flag case. You must know that he's taking you for a ride. Because he knows our deadlines. Arrive at win-win agreement with ethical approach. Win-win is created when we help another party to get what they want while we get what you want. So both parties feel that they are one. You can sometime do this before negotiations formally begin by observation and by asking questions and then listening carefully. Although you are trying to create a win-win situation, but don't be too optimistic. It doesn't happen very often. Conducting negotiations. Try and build a rapport with the other party during the initial stages of negotiations. This will help you satisfy their needs by understanding what they really want, as I explained earlier. Lighten up the atmosphere. What I used to do is to serve samosas, you know, for every foreign delegations, and especially spicy one when the Russians came. They love spicy. And then we talk about samosa, we talk about, you know, general things. Do general discussions. What about weather, about industry, about current affairs, and eventually leading to their business conditions. So when these guys used to come to Delhi, I say, oh, how are you enjoying this weather because you come here very cold, Delhi so warm, you know, that kind of stuff. It loosens up. Ask questions. Establish a climate of trust. Power negotiators are never afraid to ask the other party questions or advice. Asking questions tend to establish a climate of trust. If you're not happy with the response you get, try and ask another question, such as, why do you say that? Even if you know the answer. Discuss all issues, leaving price negotiation at the last, so that you're able to liquidate most of your points from your agenda. When negotiating, try to look beyond the requests and demands of the party and attempt to understand their real intentions and motives. And you are well on the way of winning the negotiations. Seek a proposition before making an offer. That way, you'll be able to establish ZOPA and will have upper hand in striking a favorable deal. Have patience. Don't be in a hurry to conclude contract. Buy time when negotiations are not going the way you want. A strong partner will be of immense help to speak from the position of strength. And lastly, find innovative, creative propositions and do out-of-the-box thinking. That will help. So I'll give you a problem. You know, for this very high level management post, they wanted to hire very smart MBA executives. So finally, they shortlisted three guys. One was a Harvard graduate, very nice profile. Other guy was from IIM, Ahmedabad, IIMA. And the third guy was from XLRI Jamshedpur. Okay. And the profile and work they have done was fantastic. So now they have to choose the one guy. So they give him one question. He said, we are going to ask one question to all three of you. Who's going to give the best answer, and we'll select him. And the question was, what is the fastest thing? So anybody can play from Harvard and say, what is the fastest thing? Anyone? Oh, you are still doing MBA. Don't worry, I'll tell you. The first guy, Harvard fellow, said the fastest thing is light. So they asked, well, light, how's that? He said, you know, sir, I switch on a switch here and there will be light in New York. He said, yeah, okay, you're right, fastest thing in New York. The second guy they asked, what is the fastest thing? He said, the fastest thing is thought. Is it thought? He said, yes. I think I'm here. I think I'm in New York. And then I think I'm on a Mars. The thought travels faster than the light. Oh, yes. They asked the guy from XLRI Jamshedpur. He said, okay, now, do you think you know what is the fastest thing? He said, of course I know. So what is it? He said, fastest thing is diarrhea. you, Bunny? Faster than diarrhea? How's that? He said, you know, sir, last night I was lying on the bed and, you know, I got up with the cramp in my stomach. And before I could put the lights on, or before I could think, and he just stopped. And, you know, he got the job. So sometimes out of box thinking helps. Well, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, with this, I rest my oars. I have finished. I don't know whether I take a longer than I should. And I am quite willing to take on the questions that you may have. Thank you. And I must tell you, share with you, I lost my 1 year when I was commanding a ship in IPK of operation time. Some gunfires and all that. The second one is working with some 40% or 50% efficiency. So I'm slightly hard of hearing. So you may find that I'll be asking you, can you please repeat it? So if you're louder, the better. And I told my son to give me headphones, so he forgot, I think. So, okay.
I had a quick question, sir. Ashwarya, here?
Yeah, please.
So you had mentioned that in any negotiation, you go through the complete, functions that you mentioned and, you know, make the other party comfortable and eventually in the end come to the price. Has it ever happened that, you know, that becomes the bone of contention and then how do you solve that?
Yes, sorry, because you've already... Can you just repeat, sorry?
No worries. So in the end, if you come down to the price and then that becomes a problem in the negotiation.
Can you give the proposition that you said it earlier?
So you make the other party completely comfortable and then you talk to them, you talk about different things, then you get to know their intentions. And then we come to the price in the end, correct? And then at the end, what happens if the price is really, not up to, like it happened in the flag case, right? And in that case, we did have the time so we could give them a week. But what do we generally do in that case where we feel like we're pushed to a corner and, we can't come out of it?
Well, what happens that eventually, the most important thing, as I said, that at the preparation stage, you got to work out as to where you want to reach. Okay. Because like also, suppose I'm buying items and you already have their quotations in advance. So you exactly know what is the quoted. So what we do, and what the most people do, that you first evaluate the quotations. In some cases, you already have the what is called LPP, last purchase price. Okay. And from that last purchase price, you try and work out as to what should be the new purchase price. Okay, so that kind of data. Sometimes you don't have the last purchase price that you're buying for the first time. Then you carry out a research. Like I sent the guys to outside to find out and to evaluate. So unless you really have a partner, a strong partner that you can have some best alternative to negotiations. There's no choice. And, we come to this situation very often in the Navy. Why? Because our ships, a lot of items are imported. We buy from our 28 countries. Okay. So we buy items from all over the countries. And they are the OEMs. And this is the only guy who will supply. And you have no alternatives but to buy for himself. Yeah. And that's the art that at in such, when you are fighting a war with your hands tied at the back, how do you negotiate and come? So ethical leadership is one of the things that I followed very easily. So I laid down a rule, open-ended rule, that I will give every foreign country vendors the maximum 3% discount. There's a maximum 3% escalation every year. Because the annual escalation in these European countries and other countries is 1.5 to 2.1% or something like that. I said, we'll keep you slightly above that. Every Indian vendor will give them 5% price escalation every year. So this rules openly, I said, this is what we're going to follow, a process. So let's talk about that. And like that, we close it, you know, now that you ask, I'll give an example. Pilsic engines, we have Pilsic engines on this, and the Pilsic engines were being manufactured by Kirloska. So you should call Kirloska Pilsic. And they have been manufacturing this in some of the core issues used to still come from Pilsic, but large number of parts got regionalized and were being made by Kirloska. And we were directly dealing with Kirloska, who had the you know, the agreement with the Pilsic. After 20 years or so, the agreement fell for some, you know, whatever reasons. And Pilsic said, you know, you can no longer manufacture them. So when we went back to Pilsic, now that we have the engines are there on our ships and we have to get those stores. So they went back and we asked Pilsic, can you supply and all that. Pilsic gave the price, very high prices. So I called them for negotiations, look, what is this? We've been buying these items or something. He says, oh, that is not there. The Indian prices are, you know, abysmally low. And, you know, our things, this, that, and all the carnage. I said, I'm sorry, you're not negotiating. We send it back. I got, you know, Kirloska guys. I said, what's wrong with you guys? What? So they gave me all junk, what I filled out. I said, over the period of time, you indigenize all these items. What about those items? He said, but they're property. I said, no, it's not that. You please give your part numbers to those items. So I made them do their own part numbers. We equated them. We showed them a substitute and got an agreement. Same. Every year, 5% escalation that you get and the prices. Next time when we quoted and we told Pilsic also that we actually doing this. The Pilsic prices came down drastically. So the point is that you have to call the shots. And you have to do your, you know, work and, you know, prepare yourself. So that way, and I can tell you this in my entire career, there are very few times that I had to say, okay, we are not going to this negotiations. Very few times. We are able to always crack and come back. And there are so many. I mean, I can go on reading cases in such a long tenure of mine. I have been involved in procurement. At the last time when I was hanging my boots, you know, my power, I was spending over 100 crore rupees every day, including Saturday, Sundays. Some 3,800 crore was the budget. You know, that is my thing. But I don't think these things happened.
Courage is basically required, because I don't think I can ever handle that kind of money. Thank you for sharing, sir.
Yeah.
So how did you handle the pressures like that came up with such a high leadership position, you know? Nitesh here.
Work hard, play hard. I played golf. I never get hassled. I actually took all my negotiations like a game. And my guys used to ask me, sir, you know, how do you do it? I say, you know, I really don't apply myself. I don't really get worried. Especially, and I must tell you this, a lot of these negotiation skills I learned from my wife. Because I had to go with my, you know, holding back behind her, she's shop, and she said, oh no, aisa kyun hai? I used to tell her, how can you really tell this fellow? You know, something like this, ki bhai, you buy one, I'll give you one free. So you say, oh, free wala pehle de do mujhko.
So in negotiations, many times we have to bluff or play a gamble. Have you ever faced such situation that your bluff was caught by the vendor or the supplier regarding the deadline or maybe the budget that you can go up to?
Kadam sahab, I must tell you, I never bluffed. You don't have to bluff. You have to play dumb, innocent. That's not bluffing. Okay. If you bluff, you're not ethical. People will not trust you. You have to be candid. You have to be forthright. You have to put things simply in absolutely ethical manner. Very convincing manner.
But at the same time,
I must share with you that most of the time when the prices were actually brought down by less than 30 to 40%, guys went with the feeling, you know, no, we had still got a good price. That's the art of negotiation. That at the end of it, you still feel that you follow a win-win situation. But gamble, yes. Sometimes you have to gamble, like in Slack case, it was a risk. You're actually not gambling negotiations. You're gambling your career. But you must, you know, have that strong ideals, strong views. And that comes with your expertise, your belief in your own self. It's easy, actually. It's not difficult. Does it answer your question? Or you still look not happy?
Yes, but at the same time, we can't open all our cards, right? So it's a game of like who shares what.
You're absolutely right. Nobody opens their card. I don't know whether you heard the Kenny Rogers song, Gambler. Oh, you must. Yeah. At last, the gambler broke even and he said, is the aces there I got to keep? Listen to the song, wonderful song. Yeah.
So, one question, what is your take on work-life balance?
Sorry, your voice is, you know, breaking.
I'm audible now, sir?
Your voice was breaking, yeah.
What is your take on work-life balance?
Sorry, not take on?
Work-life balance.
Are you saying, what is your take on work-life balance?
Work-life balance. Oh, work-life balance is very, very important in life. You know, as I said, the Navy was 24/7 job. Okay. But the most important thing is this. You enjoy your work. First thing. Whatever you do, either you do a job that you enjoy, or alternatively, whatever job you're doing, start enjoying the job. Okay. So having done that, the important thing is giving time to the family, to children. This is very, very important. And I'm telling you this after I have retired. I could not practice this very much in my own career. Okay. And my children sometimes still accuse me, Dad, you're actually not there. You know what? Nitesh's friend Arjun, who's my younger son, I was commanding Kittur Chandrama and I was deployed for IPK operations when my wife was due and she was about to deliver a child. And I had to go because there are no other ships available and there are some, you know, infiltration was going on to check that out. And I said, look, sir, I require at least 7 days some time, chutti. So when I come back, and you can send somebody else as relief. And it was not possible to send anybody else. I said, look, I'm a leader and I trained my subordinate, the two IC very well. And you please, you know, he'll be able to look after. If you're not able to send it, then I'm fully confident that he'll take on the responsibility very well. So he said, okay, if you're so confident, you want to hand over your ship to somebody else and come? I said, yes, I am. So I took the ship and we did some deployment. And when this near date, 7 days, I took those 7 days break, handed it over to my deputy and came here. And I told him that just remain in safe waters and, you know, take what are usual precautions, which we want. It's good that I came. Because that night, the previous evening when she got this, she had to go to the hospital, it was pouring. And yours truly had only a scooter those days. Okay. Thankfully, my parents had come because they knew that I was going for deployment and she was due. But my parents were old and they didn't know anything. The language in Chennai was, you know, they couldn't understand. So luckily, I was there. I took my wife in auto and, you know, we all drenched by the time we reached there. Past midnight. And morning, she said, look, I'm okay. Now you can just go home and come back after having bath. So I went home, took bath and came back. By the time Arjunji had arrived. Okay. So I saw him and everything else. And the next day I had to go back and join the ship because, you know, it was important. So this kind of situations come in life. And you really give very much importance, you know, sometimes. And a lot of my friends I know, they would never venture, decide to come back to be with their wives. I mean, they will just leave her, say, yeah, okay, what can I do? That's one way of looking at life. But if you have, if you're solid, you know what you're doing it. Yeah. And if you're a true leader, you'll make sure that your subordinates know how to deal things. You must have that confidence that you'll be able to handle. So there are ways you can handle, yes. And I'm just giving one episode where I've been able to do. Most of the time it wasn't same. And therefore, after this pandemic, everybody knows family is more important. The doctors are important. And not Messi, Ronaldo, and what have you.
Very true, sir. Thank you.
Sir, one question.
Yep.
Sir, in your career, like in procurement and everything, you might have encountered a lot of corrupt people. Right. So how did you deal with them, or how did you manage such people? Like, how did you say, go away, or I cannot deal with you? How did you manage these kind of situations?
Yeah, well, okay. Frankly, I didn't come across many corrupt people. Okay. There are times people are compelled to do things wrong in their own life or whatever requirement that they have. And there have been some episodes where, you know, people who are indulging in unethical practices, I would say simply. So one fine morning, I just called him and told him, look, thank you very much. Tomorrow onwards, you're looking for a different job. And no explanations are given. It's like, I don't want to elaborate. You know exactly what you've been doing. So I got them removed. It wasn't a very serious issue. He was supposed to carry out some inspection of items, and you know, he was delaying so that, you know, some money you could get or some that kind of stuff. And since I'm very open, the people come and tell you. People are very frank with you. Once you know, they know you can talk. My predecessors, many of my predecessors in different jobs that I've been, they were scared to talk to vendors. The vendors couldn't enter their chamber because they say, yeah, wo ajayega, you know, people, what people will say and all that. I never bothered, never worried. I said, anybody wants to come here and meet me, meet me. But I had one cardinal rule. Whenever any vendor, any industrialist or somebody wants to come, and big guys will come and meet me. I always ensured, no meeting was held in private. The procurement officer and my principal director of procurement was always there, present in all discussions. And I ensure that proper minutes are made and what are the grievances there noted, and then we would, you know, march forward. So that is the thing. And one more thing is that if you are at the helm and if you follow your own ethics and you have your straightforward mentality, people in and around you are equally good. I want to tell you, people by nature are honest. It's the Britishers who put wrong things in their mind. All Indians are corrupt. All our rules and regulations are made in such a manner that you are corrupt unless you prove otherwise. It is the fallacy of our system. Truly, I firmly believe all Indians are good people. Majority, a big majority of them. They are fine people with fine value system. Okay, our rules should be more supportive. It should be, you are good unless you prove otherwise. So,
thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
That was very true, sir. Sir, actually, you told, like, you will say about that Akbar Birbal story. You said you will tell about that Akbar Birbal story.
What?
Akbar Birbal story.
Okay, you know, Akbar Birbal story. One fine evening, Akbar was taking a walk on this parapet, and a lot of his ministers were there with him. So Akbar saw some shimmering lights in the far away, and inquired ki, what is this shimmering light happening? Unfortunately, Bibal was not present. So one of the smart minister, he ran around and just quickly found out and came back. Jahan pana, you know, the Karodimal, said Karodimal's son is getting married to Lala Lakhpat Rai's daughter. So it's all wedding celebrations are going on. He said, oh, this is very nice. I remember Seth Karodimal, who's got the grains business in Delhi, and the big, you know, thing. But I don't recognize who's this Lala Lakhpat Rai. The second minister was, you know, wanted to one-up, and he just went around and found out, look. Lala Lakhpat Rai, sir, is from Agra. He's got a jewelry business. And the queen's necklace actually was made by him last year. He said, oh, yeah, of course, I remember this. He said, both are very rich, and you know, I can see so many lights. It must be a big feast. And the third minister was quick in uptake, went back and came back in short time and told him, yes, Chapana, you're absolutely right. It's a big feast. Chappan Bhog ka, feast is there. There are about 1,000 people who are attending the wedding. He said, oh, very nice. He said, you know, Lala Lakhpat Rai is such a rich man, almost, and Karodimal also a big man. There's a lot of dowry being exchanged. He said. And the fourth minister was again very fast. He went down, checked back, and came back. He said, yes, sir, a lot of dowry is being given. 100 horses, 20 elephants, 20 kg gold, and the silver ornaments and clothes for all those who are attending the function. He said, oh, very nice, very nice. And short while later, friend Birbal landed up there. Dagbar wanted to tease him. He says, Birbal, what are the shimmering lights? And obviously, Birbal didn't know it. So he says, this is a Japana, I'll just find out. Every minister had a laugh. Now he's going to make 5 chakras to find out. Birbal came back and he said, Japana, you know, the Karodimal's son is getting married to Lala Lakhpat Rai's daughter. And Lala Lakhpat Rai, you know, he's from Agra. And he's got jewelry business. He made the queen's necklace last year. Chappan Bhog, the Ramlal Halwai, our famous Delhi wala, is making Chappan Bhog ka, feast. And you know what, Jahanbhara? They are so rich. They are giving 100 horses, 20 elephants, 20 kg gold, and silver ornament in this one. So the point is, you must have attention to detail. Must find out every aspect when you are carrying out a research. It is not that one by one you try and find out. That's the moral of story. So whenever you come across a situation where you have lack of knowledge, you must get every aspect, every detail, and do the complete analysis.
Nice one, sir.
Good. So that's it.
Any more questions, guys?
Sorry?
I was just... Any more questions?
One question, if I can?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Sir, I want to ask you about that. In this life, we face a lot of distractions. And with that, we have to enjoy our life also. So how to balance that thing that we have to be more disciplined to cut out our distractions while enjoying our life? Any anecdote from your life, if you have?
Yeah. What do you mean by distraction?
So there are a lot of things. I mean, social network is there. You have to go out with people. You have to, you get less focus on your work, things, kind of things.
Put it this way, as I mentioned earlier, if you are enjoying your job, you're actually loving what you're doing it. So you don't regret being at work at longer hours. That's one. But when you come to the work-life balance, that is, you got to balance your work with the life, with your family, friends. Thankfully for me, the Navy gives you a lot of opportunities. It's the actually the way of life. Okay. A drop of hat. We have something called PLD. You know what's PLD? Pre-lunch drinks. Okay. They're stress busters. So you just get around, okay, so Wednesday and Saturday used to be called something called make and mend days. You know what is make and mend days?
Make and mend.
Make and mend. In olden days, you know, all these jawans and sailors, they had very few uniforms that were being given to them. And they were poorly stitched or the scenarios. So somebody used to, you know, tear off or, you know, and then you have to mend it. Sometimes you got to make it. Okay. So the Navy used to have half days, used to work only half days on Wednesday and Saturday. And they used to be called make and mend days. So half days used to finish at the lunchtime, at the lunch hours. And the first thing you used to do is the PLD before you start doing make and mend. So these are the stress busters, you know.
Okay.
You don't overtly, when you're doing a job, when you are at work, give you 100%.
Sure.
A lot of my friends, like, you know, they say in the Navy, after a certain time, after a certain seniority, you actually become a babu. Because you're sitting in offices, you deal with files, it comes and goes. Everybody.
Yes.
I'm a logistician, so I do more. But all my friends are the counterparts who remain, you know, blue-blood executive officers. I turned turtle. So those who remain there. And I didn't turn turtle on my own accord. Navy decided to need to head logistics. So the other people also were doing the same thing. Carrying files, coming and taking cases over the MOD and all that. So you actually become a babu. And majority of them would take their files home. And then suppose you are partying in the evening, all those things, they, you know, attend that and then come back and put morning 4 o'clock alarm, and before they come to office, they'll clear all files. Yours truly never took a single file home ever in his entire career. My whole career, sometimes I may stay 1 hour, 1.5 hours, 2 hours extra in the office. But never ever I carried a single file. First 1.5 hour in my office after I became a flag officer. I never worked in the office. I had some music on, which was being played, and I read all newspapers, all professional journals. For 1.5 hours, I did nothing. I said, just read. Various stuff. Kept me updated on various issues which are happening. My work only started later. And what I used to do, that all people, they would like to finish their work, and 4:35, they'll dump all file in CEO's office. So, boss ko de di aaj. Before I leave the office, 6:37, I clear all those files and back it in their table. Next day morning, there nobody bothering me for 1.5 hours. And when you go home, it's your time. And I can tell you this, if you really work objectively, you can achieve this. There's one very nice episode, though I didn't follow it, but I must share with you. One of various senior officers, much new to me, he was double hatting, so he was doing two jobs. Okay. He was chief of personnel also, and he was also the deputy chief. Oh, sorry, he was vice chief at that time, and also looking at chief of personnel. Both are very high pressure jobs, and he was looking after both. So one day in the 5:30 or so, the chief called him up and said, Fauji, you know, I want to discuss certain things with you. Can you just come? He said, sir, you want me right away? He said, why? He said, no, I'll just change and come, sir. He said, where are you? He said, I'm at home. Chief was in the office. He was at home. He says, you at home? How come? He says, sir, I leave office every day at 4:30. I said, no, 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 come tomorrow. Anyway, that happened. So somebody asked him next day, he said, how do you manage to go at 4:30? He said, you know what, when the file comes to me, I know these guys will write, you know, a lot of kahani stories, you know. I just find three mistakes and then write those three mistakes and send back. Because I am not here to do my subordinate job. Mm. And he said, next time he knows, you know, if I write something stupid, he'll make some, you know, intelligent comment and come back and I have to work. So every time now people are ensuring it, that proper notings are there, proper, you know, analysis being carried out, and then the files are being put to me. So most of the time you'll find you do this because you'll end up doing your subordinate job.
We have to understand this.
Yeah.
That what is our job?
Trust them and teach them.
Okay.
Don't humiliate them. Be supportive. When you write on a file, you must write objectively, not sarcastically. Though my children tell me that I am very, very sarcastic in my speech. But that's a banter, a light banter, as I call it. Not meant, you know, personalized. Your children will always take it personally, not your subordinates if they understand you well.
Thank you, sir.
May I ask a question?
Yeah, always.
So, sir, you shared that you did your first skydiving when you at the age of 52. How would you inspire us to have that same spirit and same health?
Okay, I'll tell you a very, very interesting anecdote. This is, skydiving is, I think, very, very safe. Though, of course, a lot of people have died. But I'm a tracker, I climb mountains, and I virtually almost all peaks I have climbed. I made my both sons also, you know, climb not many peaks. But skydiving, you know, it was very, very interesting. And luckily for us, unlike in Silver, the Navy had made a very skydiving team. And some guys were gone to United States and they got trained there and all. And they were conducting a skydiving camp. A lot of young officers were there and everything. And I was the chief staff officer person in administration at Vishakhapatnam at that point. So obviously they came to, you know, check their arrangement, ki sir, this facilities I want, I want this. And I said, okay, no problem at all. And I'm quite into. I said, mujhe bhi karna hai. He said, why not? Do it. But they said, I was skeptical because nobody such senior had ever done it. I said, no, I'm okay. So I went for skydiving. You have to carry out minimum 5 jumps before you actually get a wing, and I wear a wing. And in that, beside, there's something called two things, a static jump and a free fall. And before you go into this 5 jumps, you can do something called tandem. A tandem jump is, you know, an experienced guy and you both are tied up together like, you know, buddies. And he jumps and you are just taking a ride. So you land somewhere. So I did tandem with him first and I found the boy so encouraging. And so beautiful when you're flying from there, top, down below, you're coming like a stone. The air that comes is, so exciting. I said, no, I'm going to do this. So he said, most certainly. And it was very basic training. He said, sir, for you, I don't think we don't have to waste so much of time, you know, how to do this. And so we were walking and doing all that. He's like, that's good enough. So you come tomorrow. So I went along with me, my not deputy, actually, he was older and senior to me, but a doctor, same rank as mine. But since I was chief staff officer, so he was under me, like kind of. So he's like, sir, aap ja rahe to maybe aata. And he was, I think, no, not older. He's slightly younger. But actually, in service, senior to me. So I said, Vagera sahab, you don't have to come. He said, sir, aap karenge to main karunga. He just wanted to give one up, you know. Okay. My boss is going, so I'll. So anyway, both of us went there and all that thing. The first jump, when you jump, you have to stand vertically erect and put one step forward and just jump. This is called static line. Line with your parachute is tied up to the aircraft. So when you jump, that line remains there, it pulls up your parachute and it opens when you go out. That's the drill. So when I stood there, like anybody else, fear. Huh? So, oh God, you're sitting pretty in the aircraft, which is moving so damn fast. And now you want to take a step and jump and hope like hell that the parachute opens. And of course, besides that parachute, there's another one, small one, is tied up as emergency call. But people forget. I mean, so anyway, but in Navy, they brainwash you when you join. And word of command, you just, you know, you don't really think too much. So the instructor says, yes, sir, jump. I didn't even think. I jumped. But I forgot that I just got to take one step forward and, you know, just go straight vertically down. I jumped like, you know, by like you're taking a jump or a dive in a swimming pool from 10 meter jump. So literally parachute opened. My leg got tangled in this. My head was down and one leg up. And you're going down. Parachute open, so you're actually not falling like a stone. So you're gliding. I literally held that tree, climbed up the parachute and untangled my leg, came back normal, and landed, beautiful landing. So happy, and everyone was happy. Then I told my instructor, yaar, pair upar chala gaya. Bole, sir, aapne seedha nahi kiya. You should go vertically up and all that. I said, okay, no problem. I did three more jumps, four jump ho gaya. Third jump. Two jumps I did. I was going for the fourth jump. I told Aruna, yaar, you must come and see how I'm doing. I land so beautifully and everything else. She said, okay. She said, yaar, tum jao, tum karke aao. No, I said, you must come. So she came. It so happened that before the sortie for my jump, the aircraft got diverted for some mission. Some contact was there and he has to investigate and then come back. So they say, sir, there's a delay of 1 hour. So dear wife went inside the commanding officer chamber and there's a glass from the hangar where you can see she went and slept there. And by the time the flight came back and then I had to go. So I knocked. I said, oh, I'm going here. Yeah. TV job. So I went. I flew down. Came, was coming down nicely, fourth jump. And I was trying to look down below. Ki, where's Aruna, my wife? So that she sees I'm just jumping and all those things. And in the bargain, I missed the landing spot. I landed up in a wrong place with some bushes and everything else. And I fell for about 15 feet because I, you know, pulled the parachute cord a little early. So there was an emergency. I couldn't get up. Ambulance came and, you know, drove down and dispatched to the hospital. Took x-rays. I said, there's no fracture. But the leg was completely swollen up. It was this big. And he said, sir, just rest for 3 weeks. The swelling will come down and, you know, and then we use crib bandage and that kind of stuff. I came back home. And blame game started. I told wife, you should have been there. So I went and fallen. And she said, who's told you to go and jump at this age? Anyway, my biggest worry was what, you know, unless do the free fall. What free fall means? When you do static line, you jump from 3,000 to 5,000 feet. And the line opens automatically. In free fall, you go to 8 to 10,000 feet. And you jump. And you don't open your parachute. You fall like a stone. Okay. And you come to the height of, you got altimeter at hand. You keep looking at it. And when you come to 4,000 feet or 3,500 feet, that's the minimum height. between 5,000, 3,500 feet, you're supposed to open your parachute and then guide and come back.
Okay.
So that is very important, the most exciting thing. And my leg was in, you know, this swollen and all that. So, and I was every day brooding about it because in another 3-4 days, the camp was getting over. These guys were packing up and going. So my driver, you know, of all people, Jagara, he came to my rescue. He said, "Sahab, aapko koi jyada problem nahi hai, main isko theek kar dega." Main, "Tu kaise theek kar dega?" Doctor bola, "3 hafte lagega." Bola, "Nahi sir, mere ko nas aata hai, nas, nas. Main kar dega aapko theek." So, I said, "Theek karo yaar." He took something called Amruta Anjan, you know, or something like that. Like, he applied and did some massage, very painful. But within 3 days' time, my 80% swelling had gone. 20% remained. But I still couldn't take the, you know, just about could take the weight, you know, not very, because it's still tender. And I was cursing. And my wife telling, "What's your problem? Why are you brooding all the time? Because I was at home. Because of the injury, I was not going to office. The files are coming home and I was just, you know, unnecessary. You know, wing mil gaya hota, you know, that I was, you know." She said, "Why don't you do one thing? If you're so very concerned, put a plaster and then I jump." I said, "Are you sure?" "See, yeah, tum itna ro rahe ho, jaake karo." I said, "Okay." So I rang up this fellow. Main kaya, "Look, I can't walk properly. You know, ye problem thoda swelling kam ho gaya. I can do something." He said, "Sir, don't worry. You come here, I'll teach you two things. How you can land on your knees or on your bums. Whichever you find suitable, just do that. And we'll take care of you, sir. Don't worry." I said, "Sure, sure." So I tied up my, I didn't have put plaster. So crib bandage bandha ye kar diya. And you know, uska video banaya tha. So I wish I had that shown to you. So I did that, you know, for the photography, real jaw. And then he taught me steps how you can actually, I found it is easier to, you know, hurt your bumps than your knees. So I chose, I said, this is what I'm going to do. And I made the jump. I landed beautifully on my bump, no problem at all. So next 10 years, I was sporting those skydiving wings. So the point what I'm trying to drive, ladies and gentlemen, you got to test your limits. You got to believe yourself you can do it. I'm telling you, you can. So take risk. Never get shied away from risk. Have courage, and especially courage in the face of adversity. So, yeah. And especially when your boss thinks otherwise. That's the time. And have fun. That budde ko sort out kar diya time.
Yes, sir. That is a wonderful story, sir.
Thank you
for sharing.
Thank you, Rajka. Remind me of those things. I had, you know, virtually forgotten about it.
Thanks a lot for sharing, sir.
All right. So thank you so much, sir. I mean, all the interesting stories from your life and your experiences. I mean, so many insights we got. We got to learn a lot at the same time. I mean, all from your experiences. And I'm very sure like everyone had a blast, you know. I mean, you have a very peculiar way about, you know, storytelling. And I think it was amazing. And so just to summarize a few points that we learned today, we learned about the stages and elements of negotiation, how important people resources are, the power of humility, and how leadership is all about influence, self-discipline, and I guess Bhatna and Zopa were the most important highlights of the talk. And obviously, other than you.
Thank you, Vijay. Thank you very much. And all the very best to all of you. And I wish you an excellent career ahead. XLRI is one of the very renowned institute. If not for your own sake, make your institute proud. Do well in life. And I'm sure that you'll come out with flying colors. The world is a big open field, and there are tremendous challenges. As long as you are true to the cause, I can tell you nothing will stop you from succeeding. So good luck, God bless, and Godspeed.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.